Tu des I worship you, my God. Yes, I worship you, my Lord. I worship you, my daddy. Today, asoko yo boro bobo bom. Ema zela dua yaba yaba. I believe. Yes, Lord, I believe. Yes, Lord, I believe. It is well with me. In the name of Jesus, I believe. Yes, Lord, I believe. Yes, Lord, I believe. It's my turn to shine. In the name of Jesus, I believe. Yes, Lord, I believe. Yes, Lord, I believe. It is well with me. Oh, Mazegeye Parabaya Bababa, Zubragaya Bashun Telebianda, O Rabaga Sukotolianda Zibeye Bebede, Arika Sukotolianda Zibeledo Shindalianda. Father, we bless your name. We worship your majesty. Our Father, we come against every interference today. We plead the blood of Jesus. We come against every noise, every noise. Daddy, we thank you because we know that you are God. You're already here, and we know something wonderful is about to happen. Something glorious is about to take place. We give you all the praise and all the glory. Thank you, Eternal Rock of Ages. We speak to the north, the south, the east, and the west. We thank you for angels, the chariots of fire. Yes, the horses of fire surrounding us. Father, we give you praise because even this recording will go to the ends of the earth to bless humanity. Father, we thank you because we know that somebody's scales will fall off their eyes today. Someone's earplugs will be removed. Father, Lord, the blinders will be broken in the name of Jesus. Father, we exalt your name because we know that somebody's marital destiny is taking shape. Daddy, we give you praise. We exalt you. We worship you. Hey, Rabaga Sukoto Lianda Zibianda. Jubele Dede Dede Guru Goto Koto Braga Yagata. Oh, Rabaga Sukoto Lianda Shiketi Lianda. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Welcome to today's edition of Marriage War Room. Thank you so much for joining us. This is Nehemiah through Prayer Ministry. We meet on Watchman Arise altar every Monday through Friday at 6 a.m. Eastern Time. Please endeavor to join us. If this is your first time of joining this prayer line, a lot is happening here. Also on Saturday at 12 noon, we have our Believers Foundation School going on. I'm sure a lot of people are wondering, why do I need to register for Believers Foundation School? I want to encourage you. Let it serve as a reminder to bring you, you know, to remembrance of those fundamentals of our new creation reality. Let it be, you know, something that will, you know, spark revival in you, in your home, in your family. If you don't attend for your sake, attend for your children's sake. Let the young ones come. You know, invite your friends to join us. And then you also have the lesson notes. You can also teach it to others. Just teach it to others. Share this knowledge. Make sure that we are running with the glorious mandate of the kingdom. Today is about our families. Today is about our marriages. And we are going to look at a topic I call personal responsibility, taking personal responsibility. You see, no marriage works just like that. You have to be intentional about it. And I'm not an expert. I do not claim to be an expert when it comes to marriage. I'm just learning just like you. I'm a learner. I'm a willing student. Anything I decide to learn, I will learn it in every area. I will buy books. The Bible said, buy the truth, sell it not. I will look for resources. I will attend seminars. I will attend anything that will make it better for me, you see. Many times we have, you know, professional breakthrough, but, you know, no marital breakthrough. Many times we have financial breakthrough, you know, no physical breakthrough. That is, the person has money in their bank account, but they do not have healing. Some people have healing, they have physical strength, but they do not have emotional joy. You know, just different areas. We are multifaceted beings, and every area of our life needs attention. Marriage is one of them. It's one of the institutions. In fact, the first institution that God ordained. And the enemy hates it with a passion. And for your marriage to work, no matter how good your marriage looks right now, it can be better. For your marriage to work the way God ordained it, it will need work. If your marriage is already working, congratulations. Add this wisdom that we will share briefly before we pray to it. And if your marriage needs work, please pay close attention. If your marriage is not non-existent, whether you are single or for one reason or the other, you find yourself in despair. You remember when we read the book by Gary Chapman? We didn't read it physically on the altar, but we recommended it. I hope you got your own copy. When we read that book, we saw that there were four seasons of marriage. I hope you've been able to figure out which one is yours, and you are taking advantage of the wisdom that Gary Chapman shared. Today, I want to recommend another of his book, a book recommendation. We will share, the screenshot of it or the front cover, and then whatever other resources, whether Audible or Kindle or whatever other apps are out there for you to be able to read it. Go and get this book. Go and get this book. Some of us make excuses. I can't afford counseling. Oh, we don't even have the time. My spouse is not willing to do it. What about you? What decision are you making to make sure that your marriage works and fulfills destiny, the destiny that God ordained? The title of the book I will recommend from Gary Chapman is The Marriage You've Always Wanted. I encourage you, go online and look for all his books. All his books are valuable. I have all of his books. Anyone is talking about habits. Sometimes it's repetitive, but we need to hear it over and over again. And this man is gifted in the area of marriage. Now, you must become decisive about your actions and reactions towards your spouse. The retaliation must stop. You must decide, you know what, I'm going to be the good person in this marriage. No matter how bitter the marriage is. I mean, the marriage is beautiful. Okay, I'm going to even be a better person because my husband loves me or because my wife loves me. A beautiful marriage takes intentionality. You have to be intentional. Every area of your marriage. Marriage was ordained by God to be beautiful. The Bible says that marriage is honorable in all, the bed being undefiled. God wants your marriage to be beautiful. He did not organize marriage to be a battery ram for us. He did not organize marriage to be a place where you come and endure and suffer. No. He ordained marriage to be a place of solace, a place of beauty, a place of joy. But the opposite is what many are experiencing. Well, I know that even as we run, with the instruction of today, there will be change. And as we declare from the altar, this because we have come to war for our marriage, as we declare on this marriage, this prayer altar, I believe that we will enjoy breakthrough on all fronts. You see, there are three types of love. In the Greek word for romantic love is eros, and that's why we call it erotic love, romance, eros. The second one is philia, that is Philadelphia, the church of Philadelphia, and one of the fruits of the Spirit that is listed in Galatians 5:22-23 is brotherly kindness. It's the same thing he's talking about, phileo, love. To phileo your brother, the one that happens between siblings, the one that happens between church members, the brethren, the church, and agape. Agape is the superior, the biggest one. And we're going to read from 1 Corinthians chapter 13. But before we read from 1 Corinthians chapter 13, I want you to open your Bible to Ephesians 4:25-32. We will read this and we get it down. Please get it down. You have to be intentional. You see, one of the areas that the enemy has robbed us blind is in the area of unforgiveness, resentment, bitterness. It starts to grow. The bitterness starts to grow. You must not allow it to grow. You must not allow it to fester. You must not allow it. Amen. And that's why we're going to read from the scripture today. The book I said by Gary Chapman is The Marriage You've Always Wanted. Every one of us have an idea of marriage before we got into it. And I define three kinds of love. Eros, that is erotic. Filial, brotherly love, the one that happens between siblings and brethren. Is innocent, is innocuous, is plain, unstained, love unstained. When you see the Bible talk about love unstained, that's brotherly love. And agape, sacrificial, that's the one that Jesus Christ gave for us. Let me tell you, erotic love will draw you to your spouse. That's where many marriages are, right? That place of indifference, you've seen everybody, you've seen yourself finished. So you have moved away from the romantic or the what they call it, the honeymoon phase. You've read many books by Gary Chapman or other marriage experts. You will see they talk about that honeymoon phase. God really put that erotic love to bring attraction to, your pheromones are, whack, or everything you are attracted, eros. We all go through it. Especially when puberty starts, that's when it's set off. Children start experiencing crushes, teenagers, and as we go through life. And then agape, let me tell you, your marriage must evolve. It will evolve from eros to filial
to agape. You pastor all those. And it's okay to feel all those things towards your husband or towards your wife. But you must know when to be intentional about them. They all have their places. And at all times, our agape must be on. Romans 5:5, the love of God is shed abroad in our heart by the Holy Spirit. It's the only way for us to keep this love going. You see, romantic love will fade. But agape can never fail. Charity can never fail. Okay, so let's read the scripture I said together, Ephesians 4:25 to 32. The Bible said, do not grieve the Spirit. Therefore, putting away lying, let each one of you speak truth with his neighbor. In this case, put with his spouse. For we are members of one another. Be angry and do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your wrath. So that means when you're angry in the morning, don't let the sun go down before that anger dissipates. Now give place to the devil. Don't give place to the devil in your home. Let him who stole steal no longer, but rather let him labor, working with his hands, what is good, that he may have something to give to those who have need. Let no corrupt word proceed out of your mouth, but what is good for edification. Please pay attention to this scripture and use it as it applies to marriage. Let what you are speaking to your spouse be edifying. Let it be edifying. He said, what is edifying? He said, let no corrupt words come out of your mouth, but what is necessary for building up. Ask yourself, is what I'm saying to my spouse building up or tearing down? He said that I may impart grace to the hearer. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God by whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Not only do we grieve our spouses with these wicked words, these heavy words, these resentful words, but we grieve the Holy Spirit. Now look at verse 31. He said, love all bitterness, wrath, anger, clamor, and evil speaking be put away from you with all malice. And be kind to one another, tender hearted, forgiving one another, even as God in Christ forgave you. Husband and wife, we need to forgive each other. We must forget, you know, those old things. Many of us have evil memory recall. You don't remember the good thing. You keep remembering evil. You keep rehashing it over. That's how you did something in 1980. Oh, that's how you did it in 1992. The same thing, you repeated it in 2013. You are repeating the same thing. You are doing it again. You can never change. No, we should stop that. We must become intentional. We must become responsible for our marriage, regardless of what our spouse is doing. I'm not saying that we should excuse our spouses, but regardless of what they are doing. Amen. Now, let's look at 1 Corinthians 13 before we pray. 1 Corinthians 13, it says that we should express the agape of love. So when you are looking at all three kinds of love, this scripture is not addressing eros here. It's not addressing phileo here. It's addressing agape. Agape. So you must agape your spouse. There's a place for eros, and you must be intentional about that too. And there will be a time when you just treat each other like brothers and sisters. It happens. Romantic love is not visible every day. Of course, many of the books that we have read on marriage says you should keep that flame alive. But you all know, in reality, that is not physically possible to be having that hot for one another 24 hours a day. Even no matter what, you know, your schedule looks like, you must be intentional about that. But here we are focusing on agape. And the greatest gift you can give to your spouse or children at this time is agape, is love. We must be examples to our children, and we must agape our spouse regardless of where they are spiritually. We can't go, time will not permit us to go read about, you know, the epistles of Paul to the Corinthian church, where he said, even when you are married to an unbelieving spouse, be the bigger person. Let the responsibility be from you. Take responsibility. I personally made a vow to God that even if my marriage will not work, but we are working our marriage, even if I don't get the things I desire for my marriage, physically, romantically, or whatever, the expectations, because the expectations we have are so high, only God can meet it. Even if I never get those things for my husband, I made up my mind that I will be that daughter of Zion. I'll be that son of God who obeys the word of God to the letter. Praise the Lord. Before we read 1 Corinthians 13, I see that there's a lot of noise on the line, especially staff meeting. If you're on staff meeting and your phone is very powerful, I know I muted everybody already, just kindly mute for us so that we can have a clear recording I don't know where the interference is coming from, so that we can have a clear recording when we share this lesson. Please just mute your phone. Praise the Lord. Just mute your phone. I've muted everyone on Zoom, and I've muted everyone on Start Meeting. So please help us, because some people are at work, some people are in different time zones, they cannot be physically here, and we use the recording. Please help us to mute your phone. Let's read together 1 Corinthians 13. Remember, the greatest gift you can give to your spouse or to your children or anyone living in your household right now is agape. Now, let's read it. Though I speak with the tongues of men and angels, but have not love, I've become a sounding brass and a clanging cymbal. Though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have faith so that I could remove mountains, but have not love, I am nothing. Though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, and though I give my body to be burnt and have not love, it profits me nothing. Love suffers long and is kind. Love does not envy. Love does not parade itself. It is not puffed up. Does not behave rudely. Does not behave rudely. Does not seek his own. Is not provoked easily. Thinks no evil. Does not rejoice in iniquity, but rejoices in the truth. Bears all things. Believes all things. Hopes all things. Endures all things. Verse 8. Love never fails. Love never fails. But whether there be prophecies, they will fail. Whether there are tongues, they will cease. Whether there is knowledge, it will vanish away. For we know in part, and we prophesy in part. But when that which is perfect has come, then that which is in part will be done away. When I was a child, I spoke as a child. I understood as a child. I thought as a child. But when I became a man, here, the man here is talking about sonship, talking about matured adults. When I became an adult, when I became a man, I put away childish things. For now we see in the mirror dimly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, but then I shall know just as I am known. And now abide faith, hope, love, these three. But the greatest of these is love. I want to encourage you, go back and read these scriptures. Ephesians 4:25-32, 1 Corinthians 13. Love never fails. Love is kind. Love is patient. Are you patient? Love does not insist on his own right. It's not easily provoked. Are these things automatic? No. We need help. We need divine grace. And I encourage you to go and get Gary Chapman's book. He gave very many examples. Some of them will be covered in the scope of our prayer, maybe in the coming weeks. Some you just have to go and dig for yourself and learn. But his books are full of wisdom for marriage. In fact, you will hear some cases that will almost like be complete overlap as your case. Don't be surprised. Go there and search. Seek for the truth. Now, the best gift you can give to your family is this agape. Don't wait for someone to love you before you love them. The thing is, the devil, if you've been following our war room teachings, the devil does not want your marriage to work. And it's not really about the romantic fantasies as it were. It's about the great destinies. There are great destinies. Your great destiny, your spouse's great destiny, and the children that God has committed into your care. God wants all of these destinies to flourish according to Malachi 2:15. And that's why you must become wise. You must become discerning and refuse to fall for the trap of the enemy. Regardless of the situation you find yourself, I believe that this truth is applicable, directly applicable. Amen. Okay, so I have a question for you. Is the line clear? Can you hear me clearly? Because I hear feedback on the staff meeting. Is it clear? Is it okay? Yes, thank you. I just wanted feedback. Thank you. God bless you. I appreciate it. Yeah, so I just wanted to make sure that we are good so that I'm not assuming that people are hearing me. All right. If that's the case, let's continue to pray. I already shared the prayer on WhatsApp. If you want to be receiving updates from our ministry, You can send us a message from Nehemiah Troop. Nehemiah, like in the Bible, Troop, Troop, at gmail.com. Nehemiah Troop at gmail.com. And we'll send you a prayer. We'll send you daily update from WhatsApp. So it's time for us to pray. I want us to look deeply and pray. I know that we have a list, but we're going to pray as the Holy Spirit leads us, and we're going to follow. You know, I like to have something to follow when I'm praying, and I love to pray scriptures. In the amount of prepared scriptures, we don't pray emotional prayer. We pray based on the Word of God. And tonight, I want us to start by giving God praise. Come on, give Him praise. Say, Father, I thank You. I thank You for what You ordained Mary to be from the beginning. I thank You. I thank You. I thank You. I exalt Your name. I worship You. I exalt You. I worship You. I bless Your name. I thank You for what You ordained Mary to be from the very beginning. The Bible said in Genesis chapter 1, verse 27, so God created man in His own image. In the image of God, He created them. Male and female, He created them. And so God blessed them and said to them, be fruitful, multiply, fill the earth, subdue, have dominion over the sea, over the land, over the air. And it was so. I want us to give thanks to God and say, Father, I thank You for the dominion You ordained for marriage, for the fruitfulness You obtained for marriage, for the multiplication You ordained for marriage. Thank You, Lord, for destiny. Thank You, Lord, for what You ordained for marriage from the beginning, for what You ordained my marriage from the beginning. I bless You. I bless You. I bless You. Take all the praise and glory, Lord Jesus. Take all the praise and glory, mighty God. We appreciate You, O God. Thank You, Lord. Thank You, Lord. Let my marriage comply with Your divine mandate. Come on, pray. Say, Lord, let my marriage comply with Your divine mandate. Let my marriage comply with Your divine mandate. In the mighty name of Jesus, let my marriage comply with Your divine mandate. In the mighty name of Jesus, let my marriage comply with Your divine mandate. Let my marital destiny comply with Your divine mandate. Let my marital destiny comply with Your divine mandate. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. You are going to pray. Malachi 2:15, the New King James Version says, and did He not make them one having the remnant of the Spirit? The King James Version said the residue of the Spirit. And why one? Because His desire is seek a godly offspring. He seed, a godly seed. Therefore, take it to your spirit and let none deal treacherously with the wife of his youth. Let none deal treacherously with the husband of her youth. I want us to pray and say, Lord, let each one of us know what You have ordained for us. Let reveal to us. Reveal to each one of us what You ordained for our household. Reveal to us what You ordained for our household. Let each one of us gain understanding. Reveal to us what You ordained for our household. Reveal to me what You ordained for my marriage. Reveal to me what You ordained for my marriage. Reveal to my husband. You will see that every family has a purpose. Abraham's family had a purpose. Jacob's family had a purpose. The same thing with Mary and Joseph. When Joseph did not understand the purpose, God had to send an angel to give him understanding. I want you to pray and say, Lord, reveal to me what You ordained for our household. Reveal to my husband what You ordained. Father, Lord, I pray in the name of Jesus. Reveal to each one of us what You ordained for our household according to Your word in Malachi 2:15. Everywhere we have deviated from this plan, everywhere that we have deviated from this ordination, Father, forgive us in Jesus' name. Our Father, forgive us in Jesus' name. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. The Bible said in 1 Peter 3:7, it said, in the same way, you husband must give honor to your wife. Treat your wife with understanding as you live together. She may be weaker than you are, but she's your equal partner in God's gift of new life. Treat her as you should, so your prayer will not be hindered. Many men don't know that their prayers are hindered when they treat their wives shabbily, when they deal treacherously with their wives. I want us to pray and say, Lord, give us true understanding of the demands laid on us from Your word. As joint partners, as co-laborers in destiny, come on, pray. There's a demand for the wife as well. I will receive it as we go along. I want you to pray that God's will go to Leander. The Bible says, in the same way, you husband, give honor to your wife. Treat her as a weaker vessel. Treat her as a more fragile vessel. Father, Lord, give me a true understanding of the demand laid on me. Give my husband a true understanding of the demand laid on us, O God. God, as joint partners, as joint heirs, as co-laborers in destiny, in Christ Jesus, Mago shed Aliander, shed light, give us understanding in the name of Jesus. In Jesus' mighty name, In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Song of Solomon. I don't know about you. I love the Song of Solomon. Very, very beautiful book. And that's why you know that God is a romantic. God created marriage. God ordained love. He ordained it. He knows what he's doing. He wants us to enjoy our marriage. In fact, the only relationship that God used to typify his relationship with the church is the marriage. He wants our marriage to be beautiful. He wants it to be deep. Look at what the Song of Solomon said. Song of Solomon chapter 8. Verse 6 to 7, it says, set me as a seal upon your heart, as a seal upon your arm. For love is stronger than death. Jealousy is fierce as the grave. It flashes as flashes of fire, the very flame of the Lord. Many waters cannot quench love. Neither can floods drown it. If a man offered for love all the wealth of his house, it will be utterly despised. Can you see? Marriage is where God wants this flame to be satiated. I want us to pray and say, Lord, we speak to the marital altars in the Immaculate Prayer Ministry to be aflame with true love. We speak to the marital altar, every family represented here in the Immaculate. Let every family be aflame with true love. Let every family, God's who put on the under, every marriage, oh God, be filled with true love. Ah, the Bible says, set me as a seal on your heart. Let husbands love their wives deeply. Let wives love their husbands deeply. The Bible says, as a seal on your arm. For love is strong as death, jealousy as fierce as the grave. Father, we declare in Jesus' name, let jealousy be removed. Let true love, let the flame of true love be fanned alive. Let it be fanned ablaze in our homes in Jesus' name. He said, it flashes as flashes of fire, the very flame of the Lord. Father, Lord, inflame our marriages with your true love. Inflame our marriages with your agape. Inflame our marriages with romantic love between husband and wife. Inflame our families, oh Lord, Father, with your filial, the brotherly love. We come against every negative, every opposite, every hatred, every rivalry, every jealousy, sibling rivalry. Our Father, Lord, we come against this contention. We bring it home. We uproot it in Jesus' name. We speak, oh God, to the marriage altars in the Immaculate Prayer Ministry to be aflame with true love in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. We are going to pray. Ephesians 4:2. It says, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another in love, eager to maintain the unity of the Spirit and the bond of peace. You see, when you're arguing, do you look humble? Is it with gentleness you argue? When you are fighting, when there's distress or when there's difficulty, is it with patience? But Jesus Christ is telling us in his words we should do the opposite. Paul wrote this letter to the Ephesians. He said, with all humility. I love Ephesians 4, by the way. He said, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another in love. We need to bear the scruples of one another in love. The wiser one, like I said, that marriage, what I find is level. And the marriage, the marriage suffers towards the place where there's a deficit in either of the partner. If one person is less mature spiritually, you will see the marriage is strained towards that side. I want us to pray and say, Lord, we proclaim the unity of faith. We proclaim the unity of purpose. We proclaim the unity of vision over every home associated with this altar. Come on, pray. We proclaim humility, gentleness, patience, bearing one another in love, in the agape of God, eager to maintain the unity of the Spirit and the bond of peace. We proclaim peace. We proclaim joy. We proclaim love, faith. The unity of faith, the unity of purpose, vision over every home associated with this altar. We pray in the name of Jesus, oh God, from every home, our Lord will flow humility, gentleness, patience, oh God, love. We pray for the unity of the Spirit and the bond of peace, unity of spirit and the bond of peace. We pray for the unity of faith, unity of purpose, unity of vision in the name of Jesus. A welding together, a merging together, a coming together in Jesus' mighty name, amen. Colossians 3:14, it says, and over all these virtues put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity. Love is a binding glue. He said, these three abide, faith, hope, and love, or charity. He said, the greatest is love. Agape, charity, love. The greatest is love. I want us to pray, Lord, we ask that you bind every couple together in perfect unity. Every home broken, every broken home, every home experiencing turbulence, every home that is having a fragile cord right now, every home that is on the precipice of breaking, every home represented on this altar, even if their bond is strong, let the bond be stronger. We ask that you bind every couple on this altar together in perfect unity. Oh Lord, we ask that you let every individual make a personal choice to love their spouse no matter what. Father, we pray for agape to reign over all these virtues. Put on love. We pray that everyone will put on love as a garment We will make a decision to put on love as a garment, to act out love, the agape of God. We ask that you bind every couple together in this ministry, in this altar, O Lord of prayer. In perfect unity, let every individual make a personal choice to love their spouses no matter what. In the mighty name of Jesus, Ezebra da sukoto lianda sibelianda, Zuba yaga sukoto lianda sibelianda nikelebegete, yaba 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 rubele bele de sukoto, rebege sukoto likelebegeto, labra yaba sukoto lianda zaba yaba ba 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 ba. Oh, Rebecca Sukoto, Yin de, Mapusoto, Yege Soto, in Jesus' mighty name, amen. Ecclesiastes 4:9 says, two are better than one. We pray this prayer many times on this altar. He said they have a good reward for their labor. I want us to pray. Father, we speak perfect agreement over our homes. We ask that husband and wife will help and encourage one another spiritually, professionally, emotionally, mentally, in every area. We break every yoke of the third party. We cast out strange spirits in the name of Jesus, the strange man, the strange woman, strange husband, strange wife, in the dream, in the reality. Oh, Father, we break love triangles, oh God, ungodly love triangles in Jesus' name. The Bible says they two lie together, they will keep warm. He said the threefold cord is not quickly broken in verse 12. I want us to pray and say, Lord, in the name of Jesus, we speak perfect unity, perfect agreement unto every home in the Imago Prayer Ministry. Oh, Zabra Gayagata, we ask that husband and wife will help each other, encourage each other, fulfill destiny together. We ask that they will encourage each other spiritually, professionally, emotionally, mentally, in every facet of God. Academically, all the help that they need, they will gain from one another, because the Bible said, iron sharpens iron. The Bible said, one will chase 1,000, two will put 10,000 to flight. The Bible said, two are better than one. We declare in our marriages, two are better than one. In the name of Jesus, we break every yoke of the third party. Whether it's a voice, we break it. Whether it's a spirit, we break it. Whether it's the internet, we break it. Whether it's movies, oh God, whether it's a strange spirit, a subtle spirit, territorial spirit, ancestral spirit, we break it, we cast out strange spirits in the name of Jesus. Spiritual every phenomena, make guests to totally understand, afflicting the marriage, creating, oh God, Father Lord, a crack in the home. We arrest our spirit tonight in the name of Jesus. We plead the blood of Jesus, and we declare there's a perfect coming together of the husband and wife in Jesus' mighty name. We declare, let there be record breaking testimony of increase of professional breakthroughs. Supernatural forces, let all of us record divine gain. Let us record divine increase in Jesus' name. We will no longer suffer losses. No more losses in Jesus' mighty name. The Bible said, though one may be overpowered, two can defend themselves. A threefold cord is not quickly broken. A cord of three strands is not quickly broken. He said they have a good reward for their labor. We declare in the name of Jesus, good rewards in the name of Jesus, increase, breakthrough, supernatural promotion on every side, success, oh Lord, Father. That one we chase 1,000, two we put 10,000 to flight in Jesus' mighty name. That is fulfillment of destiny. There is increase, breakthrough on every side. From the marriage world, we will be recording testimonies of breakthrough, of supernatural success, of increase. In the name of Jesus, we will record divine gains. We suffer no more losses in Jesus' name. No more losses in the name of Jesus. In the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. Our next prayer for you, I'm going to say, Lord, help our men to love their wives deeply. The Bible said in Ephesians 5:25, husband, he said, for this means love your wife, just as Christ loved the church and gave himself for her. He gave his life for her. I remember something my pastor used to say in Nigeria, and I've read it in different forms. I've heard it over the years. If there is a woman you are married to and you cannot lay your life for her, you married the wrong woman. You must be able to give your life for that woman. You must be willing to lay down your life. That is the true mystery of marriage. If there's a doubt in your heart that you can't lay your life, then you need to check things with the Lord. I'm not speaking divorce here. I'm saying that there must be an intentionality from the man. There must be, this is addressing him here. He said that you should give your life. He gave up his life for her. That you must be willing to lay your life down for your family. Are you willing to die for that woman? Are you willing to die for her? The Lord loves so much. Now, I'm not saying it should be automatic. It may be a work in progress. But some people, right from day one, they can lay their life for their wife. That's how much they love you. That's the idea. But many are far from that idea. I want us to pray. The Bible said men ought to love their wife. And he gave the women instructions. He said, women ought to see to it that they respect their husband. What a woman loves, what she desires so much is affection, that love, that expression of love. Especially how we see Eros, the romantic love. What a man desires so much is because they always say that, you know, men are egocentric. Men love their ego to be rough. My fact, you have to be able to praise the man, and you know, you have to be his cheerleader. But what the woman is required to do is to respect her husband, because it's very easy for a woman to discredit a man like this. I want us to pray and say, Lord, help our men to love their wives deeply, like Christ loved the church. Let the love flow from the bottle up down. Men can hold emotions in. Women can express it easily. Sometimes there are exceptions to the rule. Please, I'm not trying to generalize there, but I want us to pray deeply for marriages and say, Lord, help our men to follow the true example of Jesus Christ in Ephesians 5:25. He said, husbands ought to love their wives. You need to love your wife just as Christ loved the church. Father Lord, this is the standard you give us. This is the standard you give us, not the world, oh God. Father Lord, not tip for that. You said that men ought to love their wives. Women ought to respect their husbands. Man should be willing to give his life for his wife. Father, we pray for this idea to take over in our homes in Jesus' name. Help our men to love their wives deeply. Let the love flow from the bottom of them. Let the love flow. We break the yoke of egocentrism in Jesus' name. Our men will not be egocentric in the name of Jesus. Our men will not be captivated by ego. In the name of Jesus, we command open channels of communication, free communication, loving agreement. We proclaim loving agreement in our home. We declare peaceful, no tension atmosphere in our homes. In the name of Jesus, we declare peaceful, no tension. Oh, no tension in our home in Jesus' mighty name. Our husbands will find solace at home. Our wives, our women will find solace at home. Oh, in the name of Jesus, our children will find comfort at home, solace at home. In the name of Jesus, in Jesus' mighty name, amen. Ephesians 5:23 is the same Ephesians 5. He said, wives, submit your husband to the Lord. Hey, I remember years ago when I was in University of Badar, I attended the church, a Redeemed Christian Church of God, at Coco Donga, where the Redeemed Christian Church of God was. And it was a Sunday, there was like this talk, we were having this talk, I can't remember what the program was, and the pastor talked about submission and marriage, the topic was marriage, and the woman answered and said, oh, how can you submit yourself to a stupid man. You know, that comment was loaded. Said, how can you're accomplished, how can you submit yourself to a non-entity? You know, a man who is godless. And the pastor had to set her straight with scriptures. That it may be difficult, but the believing spouse must be the one who acts as the bigger person. It's difficult. You may not say anything to respect in the man. That's why the Bible is saying women ought to submit to their husband. Women ought to sit with that they respect their husband. The Bible said this, I share the scripture so you know. Whenever God repeats a word, it's not for tautology, it is for emphasis. He said, see to it. He said, wife, submit your own husband. He said, wife, submit your husband as fitting to the Lord, as unto the Lord, not unto the man, unto the Lord. Look at Nabal and Abigail. The woman was submissive. The woman was excellent. I want us to pray and say, Lord, help our women to be intentional when it comes to submission. Let the women not look at the physical. Let our women not look at the physical. Father, Lord, including me, Father, Lord, help us to obey your word. Ephesians 5:22 says, wife, submit to your own husband as to the Lord. Even when the man is an unbeliever, when the man is a cook, the Bible says, submit. There's a way you will need. Every situation is unique. Every situation is different. But the wife must submit. That is what the covenant requirement from you as a woman. The wife must submit. And the husband needs to love, but the wife has to submit, because God knows what a man needs is respect. You will see that in another scripture it says, see to it that the woman respects her husband. Ephesians 5. It's the same Ephesians 5. verse 33, he said, let each of you in particular so love his own wife. That is the man. This is the need of the woman. And let the wife see that she respects her husband. What affection is to a woman is what respect is to a man. You must learn to respect your man. You must ask the Lord, Father, give me the secret code to this man's heart. Show me the secret of how to reach him. In the name of Jesus, women, submission is the key. Ask for grace. We receive exceeding grace on this altar to respect our men, to submit in the name of Jesus. The Bible said in Proverbs 21, verse 9, better to dwell in the corner of the housetop than in a house shared with a contentious woman. There are like three different verses of this. A woman who nags. What is in your mouth? The Bible said that upon the tongue of the Proverbs 31 woman is the law of kindness. What is coming out of your mouth? The Bible says she does her husband good. All the blessings of her life are not evil. Every time you ask towards your husband, you do anything, check, am I doing him good all the days of his life? Is the law of kindness on my tongue? I want you to pray. No more nagging in our home. No more baby in the night. The men hate it when, if you read Gary Chapman's book, The Marriage You've Always Wanted, he gave examples of couples. The men hate it when you treat them like babies or like your children. And women, because we are nurturers, we are mothers, we don't know when we start treating. Don't derogate the man. Don't be derogate. Don't treat him. Even when you don't mean to, they misunderstand it. I want you to pray and say, Lord, I do not want to be misunderstood anymore. Sometimes you are saying the reality sounds like nagging. Keep your mouth quiet. Keep your mouth shut. I've learned to keep quiet in some situations. It's not every time you must be talking. Let your silence be loud sometimes. Go on your knees and talk to God about it instead of nagging. Because the woman has been given the name nag. She's the one who nags. Whereas there are some men who are experts at nagging, they can nag too. They can. Some men can put it, they can destroy a woman with their words. I want you to pray. No more derogatory remarks. No more cutting words in my home in the name of Jesus. Whether from the man or the woman. No more. Some men can be contentious too. But mostly, you know, it's women. The Bible really talks about women. I guess in the realm of the spirit, it's a female spirit like Jezebel. I want you to pray and say, Lord, no more nagging in my home. No more babying of our men in the name of Jesus. No more babying in the name of Jesus. Do not let me ever fall into the trap of talking to my husband anyhow. I want you to pray as a woman and as a man, pray for your wife that she will gain understanding of this thing. No man likes to be teared down. When David heard Abigail's speech, he said, wow, you are phenomenal. Now, you know what? The minute she heard that her husband has broke, like, she said, go and call that woman for me. She's going to become Mrs. David. I want you to pray and say, Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, hey, no more cutting words in our home. Hey, Rabba Gasukoto Lianda, Sipe Lianda, Shikete Lianda, oh, Rabba Gasukoto Lianda, Riba Baba Baba Baba, no more nagging, no more babying of the men, no more speaking cutting words, no more derogatory remarks in our home in Jesus' mighty name, no more contention, no more tension, no more wicked speech in the name of Jesus, no more prophet speech, no more obscenity. Some men can curse. I want you to pray, Father, in the name of Jesus, sanctify our mouth, even our children, in our home, in the name of Jesus. No more wicked speech, no more curses, no more bitter words, in the name of Jesus. Magusho toliyanda sipeliyanda. Zuka baba 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 baba. Rebeke suko toliyanda sipeleko suko toyekese. Rebeke suko toliyanda sipelebeke so. Rebeke suko toliyanda. In Jesus' mighty name. We are going to pray. We put an end to every wicked retaliation. There might be a typo in the prayer point. It's supposed to be retaliation. We put a stop to wicked retaliation. Tit for tat. Here, do me, I do you. No more. Father, we pray in the name of Jesus. We put an end to every spirit of wicked retaliation. We cast out every spirit of oppressive vengeance, every oppressive spirit of vengeance, bitterness, resentment. The Bible said, put it away from you. Clamor, evil speaking, bitterness, or forgiveness. We put it away. It says, forgive one another as God in Christ forgave you. Father, we pray for the spirit of forgiveness in our home. We pray no more bitterness, no more resentment. Some people know how to hold grudges. They can hold the malice. We come against it. Come on. Burn this and cast it. If it's happening in your home, look at that spirit. Don't look at it as a physical thing, though. Don't look at it as a physical thing. Because in the name of the spirit, there are vengeful spirits, vindictive spirits, and we want in family. There are bitter spirits, resentful spirits, hatred. You see, when it's more than the norm, it's a spirit that needs to be addressed. And the Bible said in Matthew 12, 29, he said, can you go into the house of a strong man? If it has become a stronghold in your marriage, you need to address it as it is. You must bind the wicked spirit and cast it out. Father, in the name of Jesus, we stop every wicked spirit of retaliation. Oppressing any marriage in this place. We come against the spirit of vengeance, every spirit of vindictiveness, every spirit of bitterness, resentment, hatred, evil memory, recall, we bind you and we cast you. We bind you and we cast you out. We send the angels of the Almighty God on your tail. In the name of Jesus, every wicked speech, in the name of Jesus, every retaliation arrow, in the name of Jesus, every wicked talk, in the name of Jesus, vengeful talk, every bitter spirit, every resentful spirit, we bind you and we cast you out of our homes, out of our marriages, in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. We are going to pray, Lord, let our women learn to respect their husbands afresh. Fresh anointing to respect. I receive it. Fresh anointing to respect. You see a man that is eating from the palm of a woman, that woman knows how to respect her husband. It's not because she's good in any other thing. Some people think, oh, she's good. She's a good cook. Oh, she brings good money home or whatever criteria people are. Oh, she's good in the other room. It's not that. It is because that woman knows how to honor him. He will be eating out of her palm. I want you to pray and say, Father Lord, as a woman, help me to respect my husband afresh. All the men, please, on this altar, pray for your wife. Pray for all the women on this prayer altar and say, Lord, give our women insight to learn to respect their husbands afresh. Will you say fresh grace, fresh anointing, fresh grace, fresh anointing, fresh grace, fresh anointing in the name of Jesus? Will you receive the same grace for our men to know how to humble themselves? The Bible says, submit it to yourself in love, submit it to yourself in Christ. The submission is not just from the woman. The love is not from the man alone. The woman too must learn how to express love. The man must learn how to submit to God and then submit to the wife. If a man does not listen to the wife, he will suffer losses, accidents, suffer losses, millions of dollars, because the woman listens to the woman in their life. I want you to pray and say, Father, in the name of Jesus, we pray for newness, we pray for the woman to learn to respect her husband. In the mighty name of Jesus, Father, let there be a separation from ancestral cords today. The Bible said in Genesis 2:24, he said, therefore shall a man leave his father and his mother and cling to his wife. Hold fast to his wife, and the two of them shall be one flesh. It's no longer two, but one. God wants husband and wife to be one. He wants to be one. More than you want yourself to be one, he wants you to be united. Not the way we want it, the way he wants it, the way the Father, the Son. Jesus Christ said, Father, let me them one, just as we are one. God desires that oneness, spiritual oneness, emotional oneness, intimacy, physical oneness in the flesh. He wants us to be one. Not any triangle, not any stranger, not any defilement in the flesh. I want you to pray and say, Father, we let there be separation from ancestral cords. Some people are so immature. They are tied to the apron of their parents. Some daughters are still contacting their father and their mother before they make decision in their family. Some sons, they must contact their family before they make decision in their family. Marriage is not for boys and girls. Marriage is for men and women. We read in 1 Corinthians 13, he said, when I was a child, I thought as a child, acted as a child, behaved as a child. He said, but when I became a man, when I entered into the sonship, I acted. He said, I started to act like a man. I put away childish things. Father Lord, no more childish things in our marriage. We put away childish things. Every ancestral cord that will not leave the man alone to love his wife. Every ancestral cord that will not allow the woman to submit or to love her husband or do what she needs to do. Father, we break it. We break it. We break the cords. In the name of Jesus, let every individual gain insight. Let every individual gain the spiritual, emotional, mental maturity needed to enjoy a godly marriage. Father Lord, we pray in the name of Jesus that we will take personal responsibility to be mature in our marriage, to deal with our spouse's immaturity. In the mighty name of Jesus, we gain spiritual, emotional, mental maturity to enjoy a godly marriage. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Our next prayer point, we come against every spirit of tension and contention. We come against every spirit of trouble, turbulence. We come against every troublous marriage. In Jesus' name, we come against the troubles. We declare peace over our marriage. We bind every spirit of divorce, every spirit of separation, every spirit of loneliness. I've seen women there in their marriage, they are lonely. I've seen a woman, she was just so frustrated. She was so frustrated, she wanted to do an undo. Eventually, she did the undo. She left. I don't know if she's satisfied now because she does. I'm not in touch with her anymore, but I remember her lovingly. I know how women can be in a marriage and be lonely. I want us to pray. You don't need to be frustrated. Come upon the lover of your soul. You know, like I said last week, it's the first one who loves you and knows how to love you. And then when you know how to take hold of the bull by the horn, you can fight for your marriage. We pray against every spirit of tension, every spirit of contention, every marital trouble. We bind every spirit of divorce, every spirit of loneliness, every spirit of separation, in the mighty name of Jesus, we bind every spirit of tension, we cast them out in Jesus' name. Therefore, what God has joined together, let no man put asunder, let no one separate. Father, we declare no more separation in Jesus' name. We plead the blood of Jesus, we speak to the ancestral roots, we say, oppression, separation, contention, tension, marital turbulence and trouble, the bitter trend of marital failure, we bind you and we cast you out. We uproot you by the name of Yeshua. By the powerful blood of Jesus, we uproot you. We declare peace in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. We are going to pray, Lord, give everyone on this altar the grace to be patient with their spouse, the grace to be patient with their children. Most of the time, the people who bear the brunt of the anger is the children. I want us to pray that agape will become the hallmark of our home. The Bible said in 1 Corinthians 13, he said, love is patient, love is kind. It does not envy, it does not boast, it is not proud, does not dishonor others, it is not self-seeking, it is not easily angered, does not keep record of wrong, evil memory recall. You did it in 1990, you are doing it again. You threw away our money, you made mistakes. You know, don't repeat it, don't repeat the error. Speak of the good things about your spouse. Because the good is concerning your children. Say, you have come again. You did this child. You are doing this thing again. Don't remind them of evil. The Bible says love is kind. Love does not envy. It does not boast. It's not proud. Does not dishonor others. It's not self-seeking. It's not easily angered and easily provoked. Before they press your remote, before the enemy, if the enemy that is pushing your butt, you know, you will have flared off, have burst of rage, and you say, yeah, my friend, yeah, after I got angry like this, something just came over my body. I just became this. I've been there, done that. You better, you see, you were healed yesterday, you went for that deliverance service, you got your healing, you got home. 2 days after, you flared up in anger. You were not patient. You lost, you lose your patience. Guess what? The enemy, the Bible says, the enemy, when he goes out seeking for rest, doesn't find comfort, he will slip back in through the back door, through your outburst of rage. The Bible says, the key is love, agape, not easily angered. Even when the anger is burning your stomach, just turn it to fire. Turn it to anointing. Say, hey, I will not be tempted. Castle, fire, go, shire. Lord, set a watch on the door of my lips. I will not speak on. I hear no evil. I see no evil. I tell no evil. I talk no evil. And Father, we pray. Let everyone on this altar receive the grace to be patient with their spouses. Everyone of us will receive the grace to be patient with our spouses. We receive the grace to be patient with our children. We will not speak wrong. We will not pray for their destiny on the altar and go and spoil you with our mouth when we get angry. Father, we pray. Let your agape become the hallmark of our families. Let the agape become the hallmark of our home. Let the charity begin at home. Let charity begin from our home. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Lord, help us to do everything in love. Help us to do everything in love. Some people, when they cook, they're angry. When they clean, they're angry. They do grocery shopping. We tell them, please buy me, they will be angry. Buy bread, they're angry. I want to pray and say, Father, help us to do everything in love. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 14 says, do everything in love. Let your love guide our home. Lord, help us to do everything in love as we cook, as we clean, as we nurture, as we care, as we teach, as we pay attention. Help us to care for one another deeply. Help us to care for one another deeply and show it. I don't know if you're seeing, you know, what's going on in the news, a very popular radio show host. He just passed away. His wife and children are there. Another pastor is still passed away, a popular female figure. Same thing happened to her, you know. Can you imagine what their pastors will be going through right now? When was the last time you told your spouse I love you? Can you imagine? When was the last time? You know, most of the things, what is right there in our face? We love that respect, you know, but we'll be forming for each other. You won't tell them I love you. You won't say I miss you. You know, I love the way you cook that particular meal for me. I love the way you make my bed. I love the way you make my tea. I love the way you rub my neck. We don't say it to each other. We're always angry. You've forgotten the thing that you did in 1960. You are still bringing up in 2020. And Jesus Christ is about to come back. I need you to pray and say, Father, Lord, help us to love deeply and show it. Help us to love like you love and show it. Father, give me the grace to love like you love. Give me the grace to love like you love. Oh, my God, I pray. Let us stop taking one another for granted. Help us to show deep love and devotion to one another. Let us be good examples to our children. Let us be great examples to our children. Because they say charity begins at home. Love begins at home. The Bible says in Romans chapter 12, verse 10, he said, be devoted to one another in love. Honor one another above yourself. Give me the grace to honor my husband exceedingly. Give me the grace to honor my children. Let them see that they are honorable. You see, if you don't teach your children, they are honorable from home. Don't expect somebody to honor them outside. I want you to pray and say, Father, Lord, help me to honor my husband greatly. If you imagine, Lord, help me to honor my wife. Let me treat her as a delicate, a fragile vessel, as the apple of your eyes. Father, let me be a great example to our children. Let my husband be a great example to our children, showing them your agape, your love. Hey, Father, Lord, let us stop taking one another for granted. I do not want to take my husband for granted. Father, do not let my husband take me for granted. Come on, pray. Let no husband on this altar take their wife for granted. Help us to show love. Let us be intentional about our loving one another in the mighty name of Jesus. Let us shower each other with praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Time is fast spent. I want us to pray and intercede for all those who are going through their marriages. You know that here we come to war, we come to pray. Your marriage might be in a good place. You just want your marriage to be better. Fine. Some people are going through. I remember a beloved telling that my marriage is lying, it's hanging on. It's on life support. It's a painful thing. It's a deep thing. And from that, they have carried that burden. I want you to pray. I want you to pray and say, Father, all those who are lonely, the Bible says you no longer be thankful for seeking, for the Lord is your husband. Instead, you'll be the delightsome of the Lord. Your land will be married. In Isaiah chapter 54. And Isaiah chapter 62, you'll be called Ephraim, you'll be called Beulah, for the Lord your God, the Lord of hosts, the only one of Israel is your Redeemer. The whole earth is the God of the whole earth, is the God of the whole world. I want you to pray and say, Lord, comfort all those who are going through their marriages. Comfort all those. Give them comfort tonight. Give them hope. Give them encouragement. I've seen women on the phone crying. Men don't call me to talk about their marriage. Maybe they talk to others. For women, I've seen it's the women folk that are on the receiving end. Come on, let's pray and say, Father, in the name of Jesus, all those who are going through, whether they are single parents, whether they are a man or a woman, it doesn't matter. We are not discriminating. We are praying for everyone. Visit all our singles with your divine vindication. Father, whether they are older single, whether they are young single, Father, visit everyone with vindication. Father, rise up, oh God. You are the one that put the solitary, the lonely in families. Father, we pray that you will change the atmosphere of the homes today by your hand of miracle, by your righteous healing hand, your righteous saying hand, your miracle of healing hand. Father, you manage it. Foundation. Oh my God and my Father, vindicate this one, deliver them. Ah, Daddy Lord, we exalt your name. Let's begin to give thanks to God for answer prayer. Let's begin to give thanks to God for answer prayer. Father, we thank you for answer prayer. We give you praise for marriages. We thank you for wisdom. We thank you because we are intentional. Father, we give you praise, oh God, because Lord, we will not change our position in agape. We will love one another. Ah, Daddy, we will show charity. We will honor one another in the mighty name of Jesus. Father, we pray for our singles. They will receive the bone of their bone, flesh of their flesh. We call them forth. Ah, the bone of their bone, flesh of their flesh from the north, the south, the east, and the west. We pray for our widows. Father, comfort them, especially the true widows. And those who desire to remarry, Father, give them their miracles. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Ah, for single parents, oh God, empower their hands. We pray. In the name of Jesus, oh Lord, Father, half of the grandparents, oh God, who don't even speak in anywhere. They don't speak in their spouses are gone and they are living with their children. They are lonely. Nobody really pays attention to them. They are not the children. And they are lonely, but you still love them. Father, we pray that you will visit the grandparents, oh God. Some of our elderly parents at home. Father, we pray in Jesus' name, visit them. That the Lord show them that you are their husband. Show them that you are the bridegroom. You always love them. You are the redeemer, the lover of their soul. The song of Solomon said, my beloved is mine, I am his. Father, Lord, comfort everyone where they hurt, oh God. Heal every broken heart in Jesus' name. Find up the broken heart. Father, Lord, fill up, oh Lord, Father, the void in our hearts in Jesus' mighty name. Father, we bless you. We worship you. We thank you because testimonies are found in the name of Jesus. Marital destinies will blossom, flourish, oh God. Father, destinies, great destinies on this altar. We arise in the name of Jesus. Father, we exalt your name for breakthrough. You said to us, better than one. They have a good reward for their labor. Father, we declare we call for increase, progress, promotion, breakthrough into families, oh God. We record gain, no losses, no losses. In Jesus' mighty name, we cover our prayer points with the blood of Jesus and we ascribe all the praise, all the glory, adoration. Thank you for this privilege to come before your throne. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Have you been blessed? Please remember to join us tomorrow morning at 6 a.m. Eastern Standard Time, as we continue on the altar of prayer, we are reading the book of Genesis. And then also, Saturday, Believers Foundation School, is not too late for you to register. The reason why we are asking you to register so that we can have your email, send you the lecture material. If you are not registered, you will not have it. We are not sharing it on WhatsApp. There's a reason for it. And then, if you share your telephone number with us, we will also add you to the WhatsApp group. Is not for junk mail, it's just to resolve all the technical issues and answer your questions. And not that one-on-one. The Lord bless you, the Lord keep you, cause his face to shine upon you and give you his peace, his shalom peace, unbreakable peace, undeniable peace in Jesus' name. Let's share the Nehemiah through benediction. If you do not know it, you can repeat after me. I am blessed with the blessing of the Father God Almighty. I am blessed with the blessing of heaven above in Christ Jesus. I am blessed with the blessing of the field. I am blessed with the blessing of the deep within. I am blessed with the blessing of the breast. The blessing of the breast is the blessing of marriage. It's from Proverbs chapter 5. I am blessed with the blessing of the womb. The blessing of the womb is fruitfulness and healing in all your inward parts. I am blessed with all spiritual, material, and marital blessings this season. I am blessed when I go out and when I come in. My blessing exceeds that of my ancestors and all those who have gone ahead of me. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. This was adapted from the prayer of the man Jacob over his son Joseph when he was about to transition to glory. He blessed the tribe of Joseph, and the tribe of Joseph was exceedingly blessed. The firstborn blessing. May the firstborn blessing in Christ Jesus stick to your head and that of your children and your children's children forever in Jesus' name. Bye for now. See you next time. Bye-bye.